know that as we grow, the hurdles will be more. Each time we are washed away, we bounce back to the shore. We know we lead the way, keeping odds at bay. See the sunrise tomorrow, inspire the world to follow.
Our lives will be our smart.
Okay, today we are going to start our lecture number 9 on single phase induction motor. Now, in our last lecture class, we have developed the condition of maximum torque for resistance split phase induction motor. And today we are going to develop the similar condition of maximum torque for capacitor split phase induction motor. So today my objective is to develop the condition of maximum starting torque for capacitor split phase induction motor. Okay. So this is the condition here. This is the ultimate result of that condition of maximum torque in a capacitor split phase motors. Now mathematically we are going to deduce this. Okay, so let me do that thing. So first we have to draw a capacitor split phase induction motor. So my motto is to draw a capacitor split phase induction motor, and we know that in capacitor split phase induction motor, whether it is resistance split phase induction motor, a single phase induction motor basically consists of two winding. One is main winding, another one is auxiliary winding. So let me draw first the main winding. So this is my main winding, where I have given a AC supply voltage V. Okay, so in parallel there is auxiliary winding. So let me draw the auxiliary winding also. So this is my auxiliary winding, and a capacitor is connected through a switch. A capacitor is connected through a switch. So this is my capacitor, which is connected with this switch. So this is my variable capacitor C. So this is my auxiliary winding, and this one is my main winding. So this is my main winding, and this is my auxiliary winding. So main current I start flowing, which divided into two part. One is Im, one is Im, Im, another one is Ia. So this is my diagram. Now one more thing, for auxiliary winding this is Rm, Xm, Ra, Xa. So this is the complete diagram of capacitor split phase induction motor. Now V1 or V is the supply voltage. V1 or V is the supply voltage. So if this is my V1, so through certain angle theta m, my current through the main winding will lag. So current through main winding will lag through certain angle. So this is the phasor diagram. Now what we will do, we will change the value of C, we will change the value of C from 0 to infinity. So we will change it from 0 to infinity. So when C equals to 0, what will happen? So C equals to 0. So C equals to 0 means, so my XC equals to 1 by 2 pi f c. So now my denominator part c equals to 0. So this is c equals to 0. So xc tends to infinity. So when c equals to 0, my capacitive reactance tends to infinity. So the current through auxiliary winding will be Ia equals to 0. Now what will happen when c equals to infinity? Now, when C equals to infinity, so what is my XC? XC is 1 by 2 pi FC. So now C is infinity, so something by infinity, it will be 0. So now my XC will be 0, and therefore the current IA will be V1 by ZA, where ZA is the impedance of this auxiliary winding and ZA equals to root over of RA square plus XA square. Now, so we have seen that the value of capacitance for auxiliary winding is changing from 0 to infinity in this range. When it is 0, the current is 0. When C is infinity, the current is V1 by XA. Now, there are two parameters which will determine the angle of the phasor of the auxiliary winding IA with respect to the supply voltage V1. One parameter is XC, which is capacitive reactance, and another one is XA, which is inductive reactance. So one is capacitive reactance, another one is inductive reactance. So there are possibilities when XC greater than XA. And there is possibility XA greater than XC. There is possibility XA equals to XC. So there are three possibilities are there. So when XC is greater than XA, means the circuit is capacitive one. So if the circuit is capacitive one, that means it will lead. When it is less than XA, it will lag, it is inductive one, and when XA equals to XC, that means it is a resistive one, that is unity power factor. So these are the thing. So if we draw a chart, so suppose the value of, I am taking the value of C, corresponding value of XC, corresponding value of IA, and corresponding phasor diagram. So C equals to 0, XC equals to infinity, IA equals to 0, and my phasor diagram will be like this, because in this condition my IA equals to 0. So this is my phasor diagram. Now when the circuit is capacitive one, that means XC greater than XA. So XE greater than XA. So what will be my expression of current? My expression of current will be IA equals to V1 by root over of r a square. So x it is greater than, so x c minus x a whole square. So this is my value of current. And what is my phasor diagram? Now the IA will lead. So if we draw in this phasor diagram, so now this is my IA and it is leaving by certain angle theta A, where IM is leading by angle theta M, the IA is leading by, sorry, IM is lagging by angle theta M, IA is leading by angle theta A. And this value of theta A depends on the ratio of RA by XA. So this will determine the value of the angle. So this is for leading one. Now what will happen when XC equals to XA? That means it is resistive, and we know for resistive circuit the current and voltage will remain in phase. So let me remove all these things first. So let me remove this first. So what will be phasor diagram my? So now if this is my if this is my V1, so IA will be in phase with this V1. So this is my IA, this is my V1, and with the angle theta M, this is my IM. So this angle is theta M. So this is the phasor diagram when XA equals to XC. And what else? When C equals to infinity, XC equals to 0, I equals to V1 by ZA, I1 equals to V1 by ZA. So it will lagging V1 with some angle. So in that case, the phasor diagram will be, if this is my V1, this is my IA, and this is my IM. So this is my IM, and this is my IA. So this is V1. So this is the phasor diagram. This angle is theta A, this angle is theta M. So this is the phasor diagram of the capacitive split phase induction motor auxiliary winding current. So we can conclude that as the value of C is changing from 0 to infinity, the locus of IA is also changing, and it will follow the locus of a circle. So the tip of this auxiliary winding current IA is following a locus of the circle. Now we know what is my torque. So my torque, we know that so what is my torque? My starting torque for a split phase induction motor, T starting equals to T starting is proportional to the product of the two current IA and the sinusoidal angle between them. So this is my equation of torque. So that means that just few minutes back I told that the locus of the current of the auxiliary winding is following a circle. So locus is a circle. So let me draw. So So this is the locus. So this is the locus. So this is my V1. And this is the radius. And this is my diameter of the circle, which is my V1 by RA. Because IA equals to, we have seen V1 by RA just few minutes back, when XC equals to XA, that is the circuit is resistive one. So now this is my current of IM, and if we extend this, it will cut at a point C. So in angle theta M, this is my IM, and this is my center E, and suppose at certain angle this is my IA. So this is my IA at angle theta A. So this is the locus of the current. So now if we see that we can draw a perpendicular, if we draw a perpendicular, so let me draw a perpendicular on IM. So what I am doing, so suppose this is my IA and this is my IM, this is my IA. So I have drawn a perpendicular from IA to IM. So this is my angle, and this point suppose D. So suppose it has cut somewhere in this point D. Okay. So from this figure we can say that the starting torque is nothing but proportional to IM into perpendicular component of IA on IM. Perpendicular component. Because this is my IA, and this angle is my theta A plus theta M. And we know from the vector decomposition, we can break this IA component into two part. One is through the angle, which is my cos component, and which is in perpendicular to it, which is my sine component. So the perpendicular is my sine component of the current, that is IA sine theta A plus theta M. So as we have seen in case of split phase induction motor, here also we can come to the conclusion that if we make this perpendicular component maximum, then the torque will also be maximum. Okay. So now we have come to this conclusion. So my aim is to make the perpendicular component maximum. And again, if we see, suppose let me draw the circle first. So this is the locus of the current. This is the locus of the current. So the auxiliary current I. So different locus points. Suppose this is one position. This is another position. This is my V1. Here is suppose another position. This is another position. This is my IM, which is cut to the point C. So if we see, suppose this is IA1, this is IA2, this is IA3, this is IA4, and so on, as the capacitance value is changing, so the locus is changing. So if we see in this position IA2, when it is passed through the origin, if I draw the perpendicular, so this perpendicular is maximum than any other position. This is for this, for IA3, for IA4. If we see from here, for this current IA2, when the perpendicular is crossed through this origin E and cut the IM at a certain point D, so this condition, this is my the maximum perpendicular position. So let me again remove this picture and draw it a fresh one. So suppose this is my axis, this is my circle, okay, this is my origin E, this is my perpendicular, this is my perpendicular on IM. This angle is theta m, and somewhere here is the position of IA, so this is my IA, and this angle is theta a, and this is my IA2 suppose. So this point is B, this point is E, where it is cut, that IM it is D, and suppose this is my O point. So in this position the perpendicular distance is maximum. Now if we see in this triangle, right angle triangle, OBD, so this is my right angle triangle OBD. And one more thing, we can say that OE equals to EB. We can say OE equals to EB, both as radius. So we can also say the angle EOB equals to angle EBO equals to theta A. So angle EOB, this is my theta A, and that equals to my angle EBO, this angle, so this is my theta A, so this angle is also theta A. And from the right angle triangle OBD, so this is my right angle 90 degrees. So if we draw a bit, so this is my IA2, this is my IM, this is my perpendicular 90 degree, okay. So this is my B, this is my suppose O, and this is my D. So we can say D, angle DOB, we can say angle DOB plus DBO plus DBO, sorry, this is small b, equals to my 90 degree, okay. Or we can say that DOB, so this is my, this angle is my theta A plus theta M, so this is my total angle, this is theta A, this is theta M, so the total angle is theta A plus theta M. So we can say theta A plus theta M plus DBO, and this is again my theta A, we have just reduced few minutes back, so theta A equals to 90 degree. So what we got theta A equals to 90 degree minus theta M by 2. So we got theta A equals to 90 degree minus theta M by 2. Now we know tan theta equals to tan theta A equals to sin theta A by cos theta A. Sin theta A. Let me remove all this. So tan theta A equals to sin theta A by cos theta A. Now what is my sin theta A? My sin theta A is root over 1 minus cos 2 theta A, root over 1 minus cos 2 theta A by 2. And what is my cos theta A? My cos theta A equals to 1 plus cos 2 theta A by 2. So this is my the value of sin theta A and cos theta A. So what is my tan theta is coming? Tan theta is coming root over of 1 minus cos 2 theta A divided by 1 plus cos 2 theta A. Now we know that theta equals to 90 degree minus theta equals to 90 degree minus theta M by 2. We have just deduced, so 2 theta equals to 90 degree minus theta M. So 2 theta equals to 90 degree minus theta M. So I will put this value here also in place of 2 theta. So it is coming root over of 1 minus cos 90 degree minus theta M by 1 plus cos 90 degree plus theta M. So 90 degree minus theta M is my sin theta M. So 1 will become, so 1 minus sin theta M from trigonometry and 1 plus sin theta M. So this equals to plus sin theta M and this is also equals to plus sin theta M. So 1 minus cos 90 degree minus theta M by 1 plus cos 90 degree plus theta M, so equals to 1 minus sin theta M by 1 plus sin theta M. So now we got this. Okay. So now we got tan of theta M equals to 1 minus sin theta M by 1 minus sin theta M by 1 plus sin theta M under root. So this is my tan theta A. Sorry, this is my tan theta A. So this is my tan theta A. Now if we recall the circle diagram, so we know that let me draw the circle diagram. So this is my V1, this is somewhere IA with angle theta, this is my IM, which will cut this point at C. This is theta A, this is theta M. So if we see that IA is leading to V1 That means when it will lead, that means XC is greater than XA. So when it is capacitive, then only it will lead. Okay, so tan theta A equals to, so 1 minus, this is 1 plus, tan theta A equals to X by RA, X by RA from impedance triangle. So what is my X? Here X is greater than, so XC minus XA by RA. And what is my sin theta M? My sin theta M equals to, again from impedance triangle, XM by ZM. So now we will put all this value. So if we put this value, so tan theta equals to, here we will put XC minus XA by RA. So XC minus XA by RA equals to root over of 1 minus sin theta m is xm by zm divided by 1 plus xm by zm. So it will become zm minus xm by zm plus xm under root. So this is we got till now that XC minus XA by RA equals to this, RA equals to this. So we got this till now, so we got this value. So again we know that ZM equals to root over of resistance square plus reactance square, that is RM square plus XM square. Okay, so we will put the value. So we know that ZM square equals to RM square plus XM square. Okay, so what is my ZM square minus XM square? ZM square minus XM square equals to RM square. Okay, so we can say, so ZM minus this this equals to, we can write that ZM minus XM equals to RM by ZM plus XM, because we know A square minus B square equals to A plus B into A minus B. So A minus B is here, ZM minus XM, A plus B in the denominator part. So we have deduced this. So what we will do now? So we will so we got previously that XC minus XA by RA XC minus XA by RA equals to root over of RM square by ZM plus RM square. Because we got XC equals to XC minus XA by RA equals to ZM minus XM by ZM plus XM. And just we got ZM minus XM by ZM plus XM. So we got this value. And just few minutes back we have deduced that ZM minus XM equals to nothing but RM square. So RM square, and denominator there is one another ZM minus XM term. So it will become ZM plus XM whole square. So XC minus XA by RA equals to this. So are you getting my point? XC minus XA by RA equals to ZM minus XM by Zm plus Xm, and we got Zm minus Xm, Zm minus Xm equals to Rm square by Zm square plus Xm, Zm plus Xm, sorry. Zm plus Xm. So we will put this value of Zm minus Xm in this equation, put this value. So we put this value here, it is. So if we put here, it will become under root Rm square by Zm plus Rm. So Zm plus Xm whole square, Zm plus Xm whole square. So that is what I got. So from again we will get Xc minus Xa by Ra equals to Rm by Zm plus Xm. We are removing the square term because it is under the root. So Xc minus Xa by Ra equals to Rm by Xm, Zm plus Xm. So what is my Xc is becoming? So from here my Xc equals to Xa plus Ra into Rm by Zm plus Xm. So if we know that C equals to 1 by 2 Fc, so we know C equals to 1 by 2 pi Fxc, and from here we will get the value of Xc in terms of C. We put this value here also, so we will get different value. So this is my condition of maximum torque, Xc equals to Xa plus Ra into Rm by Zm plus Xm. So this is my condition. One more thing I will discuss, that from that circle diagram, if we recall, we will got that theta a plus theta m equals to 90 degree, or theta a equals to 90 degree minus theta m. So tan theta a equals to tan 90 degree minus theta m equals to cot theta m, equals to cot theta m. And again tan theta equals to Xc minus Xa by Ra, and tan theta m equals to Xm by Rm, so cot theta m Rm by Xm. So we, from here also we got Xc equals to Xa plus Ra into Rm divided by Xm. So this is the another thing. Okay, so this is theta a plus theta a 90 degree, because we know in single phase induction motor to give it a inherent starting torque, so production of the rotating magnetic field so that it can behave like a two phase induction motor, it should be in spade quadrature. So in that case, this summation of these two angle, that is the angle between Ia and the angle between Im. So this is Im, this is Ia, this is my V1, this is theta A, this is my theta A, this is my theta M. So in ideal case, this addition of these two angles should be 90 degree, and accordingly we will get this condition. So this is all about today's class, the condition of maximum torque. Okay, so this is all about today's class. So let me check. Okay, so we have done prove this, that x equals to xa plus ra into rm. So we have completed everything for today's lecture number 9 classes. So in next class we will do some experiment like block rotor test and open circuit test, and from there we will try to reduce the equivalent circuit of single phase induction motor. Thank you.